Well, thanks for sharing, guys. I'm Sharon. I've been adjunct at Stanford, where I also did my PhD in generative models. I also teach a Coursera class on GANs, generative adversarial networks, back when that was all the rage, to about 80,000 students. And I did my PhD with Andrew Ng, if you guys are familiar with him. And I've just been fascinated with generative models and where they've come. I remember when they were generating things that were honestly, we were generating faces and people were like, that looks like a horror movie. It was nightmare fuel. So we've come a really long way, and excited to share some of the work that others have done, maybe a bit that I have done, but then talk to you more broadly today about encoding human priors, specifically through data augmentation and prompt engineering. And it's okay if you don't understand any of the words in that title. Broadly, what this means is how do we encode our knowledge of the world, human knowledge of the world, into data to improve our machine learning models? And these are two very different techniques. One that is focused on training a model, helping training a model, and the other that is more appropriate at test time, and it's a little bit newer, and that's prompt engineering. Cool, so we'll go over first like why that even matters, and it's because ML models do fail in very simple ways. And then we'll talk about data augmentation and then how to encode those priors also using prompt engineering and adding context to a large language model. LLM is large language model there. Cool, so I'm sure as you guys play with machine learning models, the moment you deviate from any PSET or lab, you start to see them breaking, essentially. And would love to hear from folks like how you've heard them break. But one really funny way of breaking, this is actually my dog, Nacho, is a model that's trained on, you know, pictures of dogs that are right side up. Won't generalize to something that is a dog that's sideways. So it thinks that's a cat. And that's kind of ridiculous. You know, that looks ridiculous to us as humans, because we're like, obviously that's a dog, that's barely different for us. But actually for the model, it's very different. And so these failures in simple ways actually bring to light what knowledge we as humans already have about the domain, about the task here, which is detecting dogs, and about the data that we even fed it. Anyone else have any crazy ways machine learning models have failed simply?
It's every like a generation, you know, like every time it tries hard to generate like hand, you know, holding something. I have, you know, usually 3, 4, 6 fingers, you know, all sorts of things.
All right, so someone said that every time the model generates a hand for them, it never has 5 fingers, it's 3, 4, or 6. Yep, that's
also
pretty much it.
I remember recently, there was like, I was generating an image of like me on the beach holding like a glass of beer or something in my left hand. And so like, you can clearly see the, you know, my hand started from my shoulder and everything. But then my arm, like this part of the hand is somehow my like right hand. So it's like, it's super confusing.
Okay, so left and right hands kind of like merge into holding that a beer can on the beach. Yeah, I empathize. I think I've done something similar. but maybe you can downscale it such that you can't really tell. Yeah, well, that's an awesome example. Cool. So that looks ridiculous to us, but that's because of our priors. And what are priors, human priors? I mean, you might have heard the word priors in the Bayesian sense. It essentially is that. It's knowledge about the data and the task that we just bring to it beforehand, and that we know about beforehand. And that could be that we know that dogs can be in any orientation, and it's still a dog, right? So something as simple as that. And we often take them for granted because I think, right, we think that was a simple fail, but that's also in part because we take it for granted that We know that about the task, and every other human kind of knows that about the task. And so these human priors are really important, and it's not just like every human will know about it. Sometimes in a domain-specific field, like in medicine, it might be like all doctors know this, and then we can encode those priors that doctors know into our models through our data. So the example of that rotated picture of a dog, it's still a dog. And specifically, the type of prior that we knew there is called an invariance. And what an invariance is, like you can see variance there in the word, but an invariance is when you change the input data, the output label is still the same. So it's still a dog. You can change that dog in the input. You can flip it. You can rotate it. You can do all sorts of things that I'll show you soon. But it's still a dog at the end of the day. So that is something that you can encode in some way to give to the model such that it can learn that and understand that and then have that human knowledge. So this was in the title. It's encoding human priors into data. And just to break down what that is, so encoding just means finding some function, just finding a function that you can represent. You can write in code to enable the model to understand this. And that actually doesn't have to be in data, but you find some function to represent it. And human priors are our knowledge beforehand about the task that we come in and just know, such as that, you know, orientation of a dog. And I'm focusing on data today. And this is actually, honestly, one of the simplest ways to encode human priors. You can also do it in your loss function. You can do it in the architecture of your model. You can do it all sorts of ways. And for example, one really interesting way that people do it for physics, like when people are training neural networks to like, you know, encode some physical model as well, we understand some physics equations already. So that's encoding that prior somehow, and people often do it through the loss function or even in the architecture of the model. But one great way, an easy and simple way to do it is through data. And it actually is very, very powerful and enables a lot of, basically a lot of ways for you to just be able to adapt the data before you even train and run a bunch of experiments from the data space. So what that turns into is this function that operates on the data is you're finding data transformations that you can make on the data. And those can be just flip, it can be rotate, and those are very simple ones that we actually use time and time again in a lot of the models that you see today, and it works amazingly well. And there are also more advanced ways, and I'll go into a little bit, like slightly low-level detail on exactly how to implement them as well. But this is that high level of encoding human priors into data. Any questions? Okay. Any other priors, actually? What are some things you know about the world? Well, you know you have five fingers, so. on one hand. Yeah. Yes, energy is usually conserved. That is an important one for a neural network to know as well.
Like all kinds of physical priors, right?
Yeah, all kinds of physical priors. Okay, everyone else has great answers in their brains, I know it. Cool. So what that looks like is that when you then train the model on those flipped dog images, as well as the right side up ones, because you don't want to then overfit to the rotated ones. It then thinks this is a dog too. So then it figures it out. The model figures it out. And it's not exactly as simple as just saying, let's flip everything and give it the same, you know, percentage breakdown as the right side up dog. There often is some kind of empirical way of finding what the right amount is. And just like getting a little bit lower level in case you want to implement this. What this looks like is as you load data in a data loader, with some probability, you can say like with probability I don't know, less than random.random probability less than 0.3, flip the image for me. And that way it will randomly choose one, you know, an image as you are loading the data to flip. Now that is great for these transforms that are really efficient that you can flip just during training as you load it. Sometimes transforms are really expensive. They take a lot to do. And I'm sure you've seen it in processing your data, even without transforming it. There's just like a lot, there can be a lot, and it can be very computationally expensive. And so sometimes we will also do it beforehand. We will also process the data beforehand. And then you would just load it in your regular data loader. Just make sure you randomize that. Cool, so just bringing back to machine learning terms, the goal of machine learning is to learn. So there are two different scenarios where data augmentation could be very useful. The most common one that people do talk about is overfitting. So that's when the model is just, you know, stuck on straight up dogs and doesn't understand to generalize to dogs that are rotated. So adding that augmentation does help it understand that it should generally think of dogs as, you know, in any orientation. Underfitting is also an area where a data augmentation has been proven to be useful. For example, in very low data schemes, you just don't have that much data. And I'll go into that in a bit, but let's say you just don't have that many dog images and you only have a ton of cat images. Because you're a cat person, but you want a really good detector, so you augment your dog class, and it's very common to have imbalanced data sets. So I think someone you mentioned, you care about ethics and fairness, and oftentimes the data sets we have are not balanced in certain classes and certain categories where we also want to have the same result. In medicine, you know, it's very biased sometimes where, you know, some group might have a better outcome than another because of the data we have, because in hospitals we see certain people versus we don't. So this can help with that. In fact, I've seen a funny thing where the model that we trained was really good on only sick people and not normal people. And so that's something to be wary of. It kind of assumes you're probably sick if you're at the hospital. Okay, now going into some of the techniques here. So let's start with data augmentation. I mean, you already saw a bit of that. But where it's very useful is when collecting enough data. Actually, enough data is like almost a never thing. You never have enough data. Collecting enough data is really hard and expensive. And maybe I can bring us back to the medical use case where it's a lot harder to get patient data, then take extra pictures of cats and dogs, for example. So that can be very hard, and labeling it could be very expensive. You need board-certified pathologists, for example, to be able to label all that data. Maybe even after they label it, there's a lot of disagreement, and so there's just a lot you have to work with just the data that you have. And those are real examples for my PhD. So this is a way to just add more data with the data you already have. And just as an anecdote, with a lot of the open AI models right now, they're data bottlenecked. So even the fact that we've downloaded data, all the text from the entire internet, we still feel data bottlenecked. And when I say data here, maybe it's a little bit a misnomer, but it really is. It's good data. It's data that will actually help the model improve and generalize towards the task we want. Because we might have a lot of junk data, but we don't have enough good data to really improve the model. And we'll see a bit more of that later. So this is just easy wins where you can really gain model performance through the data space. And again, it's about encoding human priors, for example, like invariances into your data. So we already discussed this one, flip, rotation. This is very, very common in image models, very specifically. These transforms can actually get pretty intense and different. This is a Mobius transformation. And actually, if you're a person, you look at that thing on the right, and it actually does look like a dog. And so this might get a little bit weird where you're like, okay, this is really the boundary of like human priors because I wouldn't have thought of that beforehand. But I do agree that the invariance here, it's still a dog. This is work I did a while back. And then another really interesting technique, and this is very, very popular mix-up and very, very effective, is what you do is, okay, you have data for multiple classes. What can you do to just augment your data set that much more? Well, you can actually, in the RGBA alpha parameter, so like the transparency basically of the two images, you can combine them, cat and dog. 60%, this is 60% cat, 40% dog. And I know that's more granular than our human eyes can see, but we can tell it's blended. And what we give to the model actually is no longer like, we actually don't give it the label cat, even though it's more cat. We actually give it 60% cat, 40% dog. And so we train the model that way. And this has been, again, a very, very common technique and has really become commonplace to use. Pausing there, any questions?
Yeah, how do you do that? Like, how can you label something as like multiple classes?
Yeah, yes. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I think what you would do is like in your labeling, you would put the weight like 60% cat, 40% dog. So when you calculate cross entropy for your classifier, you would just use that like instead of a 100 back here.
So the question was, How do you do that? How do you make the label 60% cat and 40% dog? And one of the answers was in your data, you don't have to necessarily one-hot encode it, and you can still do cross-entropy on it. And specifically, if you think about multi-label classification, that's where this is pretty easy. And just for those who don't know, this is like a weird, I think, jargony thing in machine learning. Multi-class classification means that you have a lot of classes, but it's only one of the classes. Multi-label classification is you have multiple classes, but there can be two things in it. For example, let's say there's a picture of a dog and a cat, which is, in this case, I guess, kind of true. But even if they were like side by side, you would still label both. And then, and you can imagine that in real world situations, that's more common since say a car, self-driving car, needs to look at pedestrians and, I don't know, road signs as well.
Just surprising that it doesn't improve the confidence.
Significantly. I know it's surprising. It's very surprising. I think, admittedly, it was kind of like a moment in research where we were like, let's try this. This seems kind of crazy, but let's try this. Because, I mean, how would you describe this? It's kind of cat, kind of dog. Yeah, that's kind of what we're telling the model as well. We're not telling it it's only one or the other. Yeah. Cool. And there are other schemes for this as well. Also famous paper is called Rand Augment. And literally what they do is have a whole set of different augmentations you can give to the model and randomly sample across them with some probability of which one it would be. And specifically, like you saw the rotation thing, it would be giving like bounds on how much to rotate it. So it'd be like from 90 degrees to negative 90 degrees or 180 degrees and like sample randomly across that. So that's another way to go about it, and it's very effective. In fact, that paper was hilarious because there were a lot of like really fancy techniques using RLs, like classic RL, and you know, like it got super fancy. And then Rand Augment came out and was like, actually, random algorithm beats the hell of those. So the baseline's pretty strong with random. Random sampling's pretty good. Taking this way further, actually synthetic data augmentation is another way to be able to augment your data set. And so that could be from using a bunch of reels that you have and generating that data. These are generated by DALL-E, but yeah, you can use generative models now also to help you augment your data. And a note here, I mean, you see these are dogs. I will say, as a caveat to invariances, sometimes things that we think won't work actually do help the model. So let's say these dogs that were generated were like kind of bad. It actually can still help the model depending on how much data you have. Sometimes, yeah, if you don't have a lot of data, it could significantly help by just telling it there's like a yellow blur. It's a golden retriever. And one really funny example from medicine is an X-ray photo of, you know, an X-ray. Your heart is on one side, but you can actually horizontally flip the image, and the heart's on the other side. And the doctors we were working with were appalled by this technique because they're like, "That's not a person anymore." But it did help the model. So despite the fact that the heart was on the wrong side, other areas, for example, still help the model since we are, I guess, mostly symmetric in understanding exactly what is an X-ray, because we were trying to get the model to go from like random pixels, like static on a screen, to like understanding what an X-ray is. And that actually is still much closer to an X-ray than random pixels, like if you can imagine just rainbow pixels all over the place. So, or closer than a dog. Yeah, question.
The things that DALL-E trained on might be validation data. Can you not have like a data leakage issue by augmenting one place?
Yeah, so one question is, would you have a data leakage issue if DALL-E was already trained on images in your validation set?
Yeah.
And that's completely true, yeah. So you would not be able to do that if your task and your goal of evaluating your model had data that DALL-E was also trained on. Yeah. But if your task is harder than that, meaning it's images that are not available on the internet, then you could probably use a technique like this. And taking it even a step further, oftentimes when we train robotics algorithms, so algorithms to help robots do various tasks, the cheapest way of doing so is to teach the robot in simulation, because in simulation you could just do a task a million times as opposed to like getting a person to like physically do help it set up these like boxes and bottles and stuff. So doing it in simulation here on the left is very efficient. However, oftentimes the robot doesn't generalize to the real world, and that's a problem, obviously, because that was where our goal task was. So you can also use models to go from sim to real, to go from something that looks like simulation to something that looks a little bit more real. And train your model on that. So that's an example in robotics. All right, I use images because I think they kind of visualize things very easily, different concepts, but it's not limited to images in any way. So if you wanted to build a model for translation, for example, one way to augment your data set is something known as back translation. And so you can go from English, I have no time, to your target language. For example, if it's French, je n'ai pas le temps. And then you translated it back, but it doesn't always translate back to the exact same thing, so I don't have time. And now you can have I have no time and I don't have time to be in your data set to still have the target of je n'ai pas le temps. So this is an easy way also to be able to leverage certain models to help you augment that data set for text. Questions?
What does like if you do this automatically, right? How do you sort of
evaluate
the results and make sure that everything's right?
Yeah, it's such a good question. So the question is, if you do this all automatically, how do you validate that this is all correct, right? Because this could be totally off. It could be wrong. I mean, you're training a translation model. What's fascinating about some of these techniques is that it's okay if it's noisy. And sometimes we consider this more like weak supervision. So these are just like augmenting our data set in a weak way where some of it is wrong. Some of it is wrong, but then what we add to it, since we can add so much of it, it is so much of it more is right, and it's so much more information to the model, it will still help our downstream performance. That being said, just like really anchoring on data quality, if you do go clean those up in some other way, it will help your model. So, yeah. And there are ways to weight certain examples more or less, depending on your understanding, like the probability, the likelihood that a sample is correctly labeled or not. And so you can also go by that. That's a great question. Cool. All right, so all of that was like things you can do to your input data before you train it. So you can then go train your model and then see its performance. What happens when you're done training your model? It's out in the wild, you've deployed it, what do you do then? We're looking at now, instead of training time, it is test time, right? This is what we're doing at inference time. How do we encode human priors there? And for this, I'm going to focus on large language models, LLMs, which have, you know, been taken over the news even further than the computer science department, math department, all the way down to, I think my grandparents know what it is, so kind of cool. So like ChatGPT and GPT-3.5. So prompt engineering. So prompt engineering is the art, I want to say, of changing the input at test time to elicit desired results. And for example, this is, moving up the screen for shade. And for example, this is a really funny example. This is real. So if you go ask one of the language models out there to write you a letter of recommendation, sorry, just trying to automate my job, just kidding. Write a letter of recommendation for a student, it can write you a letter of recommendation. But if you tell it this extra thing of who gets into MIT, it writes a much better recommendation letter. So maybe, you know, maybe the student will actually get into MIT if you do that. So it is funny how it's like that, but you are telling the model a little bit more information about what you want it to generate. Hey, instead of the average recommendation letter that you have seen with high probability in your data set, give me something that's like, you know, I'm nudging you in this MIT direction, which, you know, then it will start talking about things that are more around STEM as well. Cool. And we've all been doing this, actually, before ChatGPT, before GPT-3. We've all been doing this for a decade on Google search. So we've been also adapting our queries on Google quite a bit, right? And you can also probably do the same thing on Google and get a different result when it comes to a recommendation letter like that. It won't be a generated thing, but the search results would probably change. Cool. So people often ask me why LLMs are so special. And I think LLMs are so special because of their interface. And it's that this interface is language. And the reason why that interface is special is because it matches how we think about the world and communicate with the world and with each other. And it's really fitting to that. So this easy language interface matches onto our human priors quite well and how we can reason about the world. So just to tell you what the world was like before LLMs with a lot of these models. These models did have knobs. We had these crazy great models. In fact, for DALL-E, it's like half LLM and half this vision, you know, generative vision model. And we actually had that model for a very long time. And I believe it started with, DALL-E started with UNET. We had that model for a very long time. We were able to generate images for a very long time like that. But we had to do all these crazy techniques to be able to even figure out what the knobs were. Like, to even figure out, like, I'm gonna move, you know, this vector in latent space, like, you know, northeast by this much. Sorry, it's not actually northeast, there are like n dimensions, but northeast by the, like 0.2 and like move it, you know, up by like 0.8 or something like that to change the hair color of this person. And, you know, it kind of got it right, kind of didn't. And we found these knobs and we were like tuning these knobs and figuring out what those knobs were. And there were whole PhDs written about image disentanglement and disentanglement algorithms to figure that out. And now, you know, the knobs, we don't need knobs. We don't need sliders. We have language to fully be able to basically query and communicate our desires to these models. And we had these models the whole time. We just didn't have that ability to interface into them, which is kind of crazy. And here's a Stable Diffusion pic, a unicorn llama. There's probably absolutely no way that was possible before. But yeah, there you have it. Also mixing and matching different concepts, I think, was also enabled. Because with those knobs, you had to like, I think disentanglement, you know, there were a lot of techniques. The best techniques were supervised. So you had to just know what the, you know, think of certain knobs and you're like, I'm going to think of hair color. I'm going to think of eye color. And then you go find them in the model. There were also unsupervised techniques where you didn't have to know them beforehand, but they didn't work nearly as well. Cool. So a bit more on, so that's why language is so powerful. And now a bit more on prompt engineering. For prompt engineering, it still does matter what model you're working with. This on the left with GPT-3, actually, if you go on, they've fixed it. It's different now. But the models are trained on different types of data. And it's really data that changes how the model behaves completely. And now here on the left, you might think, oh, GPT-3, it's wrong. You know, what is your first name? You put in, what is your first name? And it outputs, what is your last name? Before, you know, criticizing it, maybe we can think like, actually in the scenario of a form, of generating a form, it's right. It totally is right. And what's fascinating here is just that it's right, but it's also not what you wanted. You wanted it to answer what its name was. So here in Chat GPT or GPT 3.5, which is also Instruct, where they trained the model a little bit longer, it actually wasn't that much more data on commands. It was able to answer commands more because it now thinks it's in the scenario of filling out a form. So I actually wouldn't say this is right or wrong. This is just, it's in a different scenario. And the best framing for this is think about these models as aliens from another planet trying to be human. And they don't know, when you give it this info, they don't know what scenario they're in and what you actually want from it. And we actually come in with the prior when it comes to these models that we want an answer. When we go onto Google and ask a question, we want an answer. But when you're actually writing a form, and that's what the data was trained on, you're not asking for an answer. You actually are trying to just generate a form. So we're coming in with that prior, with that understanding of that task. And so what they did here was encode that task in by collecting a lot more human labels on people going back and forth on writing a command and writing an answer, writing a command and writing an answer. And I think it was on the order of tens of thousands of data points. So it wasn't horribly large. You can get some eager grad students to do it. cool. So can we nudge it to do what we want, and we totally can. So we just need to give it a little more context that we're filling out a form. And so in this case, you can say, what is your last name? Kane. What is your first name? And then it'll output something like Tom. It'll now know, okay, you're filling out a form now. Got it. So there are ways to do that. And giving more and more examples of both the format of what you want, like the style of what you want, and the type of information that you want, it will also be able to mimic that. Cool, so you'll get to experiment with that in the lab. So you'll get to explore changes in prompt engineering, and you'll get to create also kind of a prompt template or a context template to be able to reuse certain prompts and do so programmatically. And then also add examples to boost the performance of the model within the prompt window. And really, this is all about data. The data that you feed it in the prompt, that's data. All of that is data. This isn't much, which is great. It's much less than we needed before since we already have these pre-trained models. But it's still data, and the context you give it, give these models matters, both at training time and test time. Cool, and that is it. Thank you. Questions? How are we on time? Not bad.
So there's so many human priors. So there's so many human priors like this. How do you know how to systematically cover the priors that you need to train your model, to show your model?
Yeah, so I think a lot of that comes down to error analysis. And this is looking at the data after you've trained a model. So looking at the data after you've trained a model, you realize, oh, it can't generalize in all these different ways that I think are simple failures from the model. And I think that cues into what human priors are necessary. Because it might already be encoded. Like, you might have already, when you collected the data set of dogs, for example, you might have already, let's say you weren't just taking profile pictures of dogs, you actually got dogs that were kind of all over the place or rolling on the ground. Then your model might be fine, and you might not need to encode those priors. So I think a lot of these are motivated by two things. One is definitely through error analysis of understanding where the model is, and that's especially through, especially in the case of overfitting, when the model overfits. And then I think the other case is if the model's underfitting or you don't have enough data, it also is a way to be able to augment your data set very fast. It's interesting because sometimes I think research now is much more, they kind of love this because it actually gets a model to work, these methods. But I will say there was a time in research when it was kind of looked down upon because it wasn't like doing stuff from scratch entirely. It was encoding like all this human knowledge and we should just be able to have the model figure it out. But arguably the data sets we give it are kind of bias towards like things that we've collected or things that were easy to collect, easy to scrape off the internet. So this is a way to kind of adjust for that and correct for that for the task we actually want it to do. Oh shoot, I didn't restate the question. Did I? Okay, the question was, how do we know which human priors to actually encode since there are so many? Other questions? I think you had a question here.
Yeah, Karen. But it's interesting. Could you chat a bit about there are other approaches, right? So you could imagine instead of having the model do everything, encoding human priors in the model does everything the human is thinking, right? That the human could be more self-aware of what they're asking. That could also be another potential way. So you could imagine the second model or some other stage that's actually helping humans be more aware of when I'm asking this, what am I really asking? Like, in your mind, you might be like, just do this, or here's the prompt, and then I expect something, but you're not necessarily being self-aware of the words you're typing and how a model will try to respond to them. And so then a bunch of researchers have to like encode that human prior for you, but you could imagine another where it's a separate process, and you have some other model that's like helping humans write better prompts mixed in with the standard GPT-3 or something. Do you know what's going on in this area?
Yeah, so the question was, shouldn't humans be a little bit more self-aware? Or are there ways to enable humans to enable us not necessarily to encode human priors, but maybe some other method such that we can catch whatever is being asked in the prompt to be able to be either mapped to the desired prompt into the model or asked back to the human maybe for to elicit more information. And there definitely is work on this. What's actually really funny, I did this really quick experiment, you can do it too, which is grabbing, if you guys have played with Stable Diffusion, what's cool is you can have that unicorn llama. But when you give it just a little bit more, like you nudge it, you're like 4K, and then it like makes it higher resolution. And there are a bunch of like random things that you can tell it. But finding that is hard. So what I did very quickly was just grab a lot of those prompts, put it into GPT-3, and then I wrote Unicorn Llama, and it was able to complete it with 4K, bokeh, like something, trending on like ArtStation or something like that. And so it was able to just do that to be able to write those prompts for us. So yes, people are working on those layers in between to go from our intention to what the prompt should actually be. And what's, I think, very exciting with ChatGPT is that it will also elicit a little bit more information from you. And so that is also put in the training data to help us actually, actually provide more information. And this is very, very much parallel to how you search on Google, right? When you search something on Google, you actually can see now, like, there are suggested extra things, and that's trying to hone you in to a different space. Thank you.
I guess for examples like where you're training image recognition, could you have some sort of system that where you have like train data, test data, could you have some sort of system that finds the invariances that aren't being picked up on between the test and training data and tries to generate automatically augmented training data?
Yeah, 100%. And I think there are those two-stage schemes where it's not exactly your, restate the question. So the question was, great question. Can you do something automatically to find invariances in the data? Can you have the model find invariances through validation in some way before you run it on the test data? And absolutely you can. And there are two-stage processes that try to find that and try to find, hey, where is the model failing? And be able to especially generate synthetic data around it and generate invariances around certain data points to correct for it. Yeah.
It seems sometimes there's maybe like a fine line between like biased results and human priors lacking. So for example, like I guess a while back, maybe like GPT-3 might have a problem where when you talk about a doctor, they would use like a male pronoun, assuming that the doctor's a male. But is that a case where you consider, oh, we just haven't given enough human priors that says doctors can be female as well? Or is that like a deeper rooted problem in the data that is like there's so much bias that is already deeply rooted in data you can't really fix with human priors techniques? Or like, I guess my question is how, like, is it the same problem or is it like a different problem that cannot be solved with human priors techniques that you talked about here?
Yeah, great question. So the question was, given that there, is bias in the data set, is this a job for human priors to be able to correct for it? For example, with GPT-3 previously, when you said a doctor, it assumed it was male, assumed the doctor was male. So I think this is a place where data augmentation and encoding human priors can be very helpful in helping with that bias, but I do think there is still a ways to go to help with that, but that is a lever that you can use to very much improve it, and I believe that is actually what they're doing nightly with ChatGPT. Like when they find errors, they kind of augment it through those errors, or they tell the model not to produce certain results when they see certain things, and that is a lot of that is done through the data in the data space. I think you had a question before. Okay, sorry.
Yeah. Just a quick question about how the prompt engineering is actually deployed. So in case of like Google search, you're actually seeing the suggestion, right? So it's exposed to the user. But if I'm not mistaken, you're mentioning there's another layer that is behind the user, and the model can be prompted to kind of go to a different output based on the desired priors that we want to encode that piece.
I think I don't fully understand the question. Keep talking.
So the engineering, the prompt engineering, is it always exposed to the user, or can it be in a way where, you know, you're asking something and then it's going to get engineered, prompt engineered, and the user's not even going to see that his or her prompt is changing before it's getting fed to the model?
I see, I see. So the question was, when you're prompt engineering, do you know if the prompt that you're giving the model will be transformed before it's actually given to the model, or whether it's directly inputted to the model? And I think that depends on how you want it to be deployed. For example, I believe in the GPT-3 playground, this might not be the case anymore, but in the GPT-3 playground, it is not being transformed. You can just input something and you'll get the desired output. In ChatGPT and in Google, I believe there is something being done to process that, to both block certain requests and also just to adapt the request to be a little bit more conformed to what the model is thinking. Now, if you train the model more on taking in commands or taking in certain types of data in the prompt, you might not need that extra layer because you've already tuned the model towards that. As a high-level step back on large language models, literally, all they're doing is they're trained to predict the next word. It's not actually next word, it's next token, but you can think of it as just like the next word. And so at every step of the way, when it sees all of your words beforehand, it's just thinking, what are the possible words I could say here? And I have a distribution of possible words. And so I do that at every step of the way. And so if you change the words there that you put into the model, you might be able to get different words out or different distribution to sample from. Did you have a question?
Yeah, I had a question for going back to the whole doctor thing with something like a GPT. Could you do some sort of like automatic logic, like formal logic system where like if you say like occupations might generally be like fairly even between like male and female, could it then like learn to embed like a descriptor like doctor into like the occupation space and know like to automatically like every like half of the time assign like male or female pronouns to what it's talking about to avoid these sorts of issues? Like could you do automatic logic generation?
Yes, you definitely can do that. Oh, so the question is, can you embed some sort of logic into the model such that for the case of the doctor example of it always, you know, assuming that it's male, can you actually make the distribution more even or fair and be even between the two genders? And you definitely can do that. The main trade-offs to consider are probably around latency and performance, because whatever you add will add that latency. But other than that, yes, I believe that's how people are also considering how they address bias in the data. Other questions?
What kind of, like, I know like about one framework for example to sort of like take the images and generate the prompts for them, which is like Clip Interrogator.
Yeah.
Like, Stable Diffusion. But like, are there any other frameworks that are sort of helpful and like sort of easy to use?
Oh yeah, so the question is, I've seen a few examples where, you know, we can have some kind of tool using Clip, for example, to be able to go from images to prompts that we could possibly use. Are there other tools out there to help us? Is it to create prompts, craft prompts?
To create prompts.
Yeah, to create prompts. Yes, and you'll get to explore that in your lab as well, one of those things. It doesn't necessarily have to be... So I think there are two ways to help you with prompts. One is to think about exactly like the exact words you should be putting into the prompt and like really crafting that. I actually believe long-term that will go away somewhat. There will be better ways of handling that, especially with larger data sets and the ability to tune towards what you really want. And then I think, and be able to like just understand what people really want as they are asking the model to do something, what we want this model to do. There are also methods like you'll play with this like context template to be able to scale your prompts a bit better. So it's kind of like having a template where you have variables and you'll be able to loop through things. I can even show you. So this is what it would look like. So for the exercise, you're actually going to be using an LLM to write emails for all your clubs. But the template here is actually just writing a random email. So what you want to do is actually be able to specify what the subject of these emails would be. And just to give you cue into what this might look like, you could have a context like write an email for the club name club and have an argument like club name. You can create a template with it. And what's cool is that with this LLM, you instantiate it, you can fit it to your template, and then you can loop through your different club names like movie club, running club, math club, and then you can run it and it'll just predict club name equals whatever that club name is, and it can output it through this template. And that's a way to really quickly scale what you want your model to do. And at that point where you can build this out, and you'll see this through your different exercises, it'll start to, this template you'll start to realize will be really helpful in being able to generate different things. It'll really scale. More questions? Did you learn something? Okay, cool, good. Awesome. All right, well, thank you guys so much for coming.